The Hamish and Andy Show podcast, powered by Amy. Lucky you're with Amy.
3, 2, 1.
Oh, it's been a hard day on the tools. Lads haven't even had a chance to talk about
action films.
At school, we've been learning a lot of pointless dribble. Finally, I get to learn about
Action films.
It's been a hard day being Kerri-Anne Kennelly too, and thank God it's 3 o'clock and I can concentrate on one thing.
Your favourite topic, Kak, action films.
Thank you, Hamish and Andy's happy hour.
No worries. Good afternoon, everyone. Hamish and Andy with you for another happy hour. The way this show works, it's one topic per day. You can go and check out the topics, but only online, hamishandandy.com, and correspond with us there. You're probably in the show.
And don't worry, look, if you're not a fan of action films, that's okay. We hope you've been part of this show for long enough to go, look, it's the people's show. It's built by you. It's built by your emails, your input. It's probably not going to be that much about action films.
Die Hard, though, Ham, is an action film, and it was, in fact, the most corresponded show we had, the film we had talked about.
Yeah, we got a lot of people not enjoying one or two of the Die Hard trilogy, but as an overall, they love them, or more than a trilogy now.
Here's a little fact from it. That very famous scene, Bruce Willis runs across the broken glass in bare feet when all the bad guys shoot all the glass around because they know he's barefoot. Well, they don't just go around and try and kill him.
Nope.
Ah, let's make him uncomfortable in his feet.
Yep.
Anyway, to capture that movie across glass, he wore special rubber shoes with feet made mold into feet.
Fake rubber feet.
Fake rubber feet.
You giant wuss bag, Willis. Cut your feet. You're getting paid enough. I want to see you bleed, Willis.
Well, that's a bit full of.
Was the director's direct quote.
I have so much to get through. I want to delve into the area of at what age are you allowed to watch action films straight after this? Because I know it's differing from all three of us in this room.
Yeah, there is an age we're allowed to be in an action film as long as it's Beverly Hills Ninja and you're the child in it. But no more action than that.
Today the topic is action films. Did you ever a mate, probably more primary school year level, maybe it's creeping into high school.
Yep.
That you knew that you'd be able to watch a slightly more, I suppose, adult film.
I mean, people primary school, around about primary school age, I think it was at Nathan's house that we were able to probably watch. That's where I saw a lot of the Jean-Claude Van Damme films.
Yep. For us, it would have been Dolph Lundgren, Van Damme, Arnold Schwarzenegger and his
all the guys that are still in films now in The Expendables. But back then it wasn't ironic. Back then they were very good at what they did.
So you Nath's house, you knew you could
you go to Nath's house.
So what was it about Nath's house that
he had older brothers too, so they had an abundance of those films.
Yep.
See, that was the trouble. And I did have an older brother, but we weren't a family that had the bought VHS cassettes. You know, you could go to Target or something and actually buy and own one. We only owned three actual films.
Mm-hmm.
Cool Runnings, Clueless, and I can't. And I think Locke had one of the Star Wars.
Yeah,
maybe episode 4.
Jack, how about you? I mean, we'll talk about this earlier. You had a very.
You were living in what can only be described as a highly censored environment.
So MA 15 plus had come in by the time I was about 11 or 12.
Yep.
But my mum didn't work out what the difference between MA and M's were.
Because M's just recommended 15 plus.
My mum was very strict
it's for the thinking 12-year-old.
Yeah, MA, they're checking your ID.
Yep.
Mum was very strict on anything M wasn't, almost like it was illegal to let your child watch an M.
So did you have a mate that you could go around?
We were allowed to go around. We went to Tyrone's house. He lived across the road from us.
T-Dog.
But he never wanted, we could watch those films with his mum, but he never wanted to watch them. He always wanted to go out on the street and kick the footy, which me and my brother hated because it's the only place where you could watch M movies.
I had a mate that whose parents would allow us to watch these films, even if we were there, right? Even if they were there.
Yeah, right.
I just want to know whether my mum knew it was this mum. So I was thinking in an experiment quite now, we just call my mum up.
Right, so she probably won't be listening to this, let's be honest. Can you tell us who was the kid? And then we'll give her a buzz. We'll give her three guesses to see if she gets it.
It was Marty Kennan.
Oh, Ken Dog.
Yeah.
No, that doesn't surprise me. I've only met Marty recently, but
You're right. Yeah. They had four boys in their house.
He looks like the kind of guy that's grown up. He's seen some things. Wise eyes.
Okay. Hey, Mum.
Hi, darling. How are you?
Yeah, very well, very well. I'm here with Hamish and
Hi, Margie.
Hello, Payne. How are you?
Very good. Andy's got an exciting game for you to play.
Well, can I just interrupt? I've got the case manager at the moment, so is it going to be very quick?
So quick.
Yeah, sure, Mum. Sorry, just tell you to pause for a second. Back in the day, Mum, of my primary school friends,
yes.
Okay, I was allowed to watch more gory films at a certain person's house, and I wondered, as a parent, did you suspect any of my friends' parents as perhaps being the lackadaisical ones on protecting our eyes?
We're talking like M, even R-rated films, Marg, when Annie was only 8 or 9 years old. Whose house do you reckon that happened at?
I can't. Well, it certainly wouldn't have been Willie Neal.
No, not Willie.
Really. He's off the hook.
Yep.
And I don't think it'd be Marty Cannon.
What are you thinking? Is that what you're thinking or not?
No, I don't think it'd be Marty Cannon.
It was Marty Cannon.
He's got you! Oh, the innocent little Ken dog. Yes.
And was it him?
Yeah, it was him. Apparently, his house is a den of... I just watched Red Scorpion
and... just Gore. We should make that very clear.
Still, who knows what was going over there, Marty?
No, actually, Marty Cannon's mum wouldn't let you go to a movie, and she thought that would have been too.
I think it was more the dad more than Wendy mum, Marty's mum that was just being a bit looser
with Papa Cannon, bit of a loose cannon,
yeah.
Just allowing the kids to watch whatever they want. Well, Marg, now that the statute of limitations has been lifted, some almost 25 years later, we feel that that secret can be exposed without any repercussions. Is Andy still allowed to play with Marty?
Well, certainly. I'm very fond of Marty.
Yeah, he's a good guy.
Beautiful guy.
All right, Mark, love you. Speak to you later.
Okay,
bye. Bye, Marky.
Sorry to bother you. Drink the case manager.
She wouldn't be listening.
Hey, a lot of people talking about one-liners. That classic
action staple for action films. That is the topic for today.
It made me think, I wonder how, if you had what it takes. I mean, you often talk about maybe turning to a life of going around as an espion, a spy or something like that.
I do have Harrison Ford's eyes. So yeah. When you've got the eyes for the job, the rest of the body follows, is what my agent says.
Maybe you do. Maybe you've got the opportunity, but I'm not sure if you've got the one-liners. Are you able to think of a nice pun, a nice quip, once you've disposed of a body?
I've got more one-liners. Mm-hmm. Than the truck that paints the one line along the highway. That's kind of a lot of one lines in that
we
truck.
We hadn't officially started the game.
Well, I'm on.
That one doesn't.
I'm on. Put that in the film.
Well, that one doesn't go to the jury. That one, we'll leave that one from your scorecard. I've got a bit of an idea, Ham, where what I'm going to do is I've taken actual one-liners from action heroes from three different films.
Right.
I'm going to describe the scene to you.
I've got to know a bit of the backstory. Yeah, it's very important.
I'm going to describe you. I'll say the film. I'll give you your character. I'll describe the scene to you in the lead up, and then...
Almost hypnotizing me into it.
And then I'll go, and then you say, and that's when you've got to
blow the audience away.
Yeah.
Just earn my ticket price.
All right, the first film is Batman and Robin.
Great, haven't seen it, so I won't be clouded.
You are cast as Mr. Freeze, right?
That's a shame.
He's a big guy, he's a villain.
Yep.
It's the final showdown, and you're standing there with your freeze gun.
Yeah, was this Arnold Schwarzenegger?
Yeah.
Yep.
Which can freeze opponents. A freeze opponent solid.
Yeah.
Right? Batman walks in, and you turn to him, you turn to your henchman.
Yeah, I've already got a line in my head.
And you say,
somebody give him a Sudafed. Looks like he has a cold. And then I freeze him.
Not bad. A Sudafed is...
Or, insert chance for sponsorship.
Yeah,
you can leave it blank. I'll just move my mouth and in the local markets you put in different drugs.
I'm not sure if Sudafed is worldwide, but that's fine. The line they used was, time to kick some ice.
Not very good. I mean, maybe you get away with Schwarzenegger. You'd have to know you're writing for Arnie then as a script writer because that's not an obvious pun.
Yes. All right.
All right.
I'm going to say...
C+.
Yeah.
I'll say C+.
I'm going to say both of them were bad.
Yeah, fair enough.
So you don't get the win or the loss. Right. The next film...
Who am I?
Clive Owen, be replacing his character. The film is Shoot 'Em Up.
Never heard of it, but I can guess the plot line.
You're in part of a massive battle scene. It's a hand battle.
I'm fighting him.
You're fighting him. You grab a carrot and you force it through your opponent's mouth so it comes out the back of his head.
What? He I've killed him.
Yes. He slumps, to the, he slumps to the ground and you say...
What's up, Doc?
I reckon it's better. Yours is better. His is... Always eat your vegetables.
He hasn't really eaten any. You just killed him with it.
So, one
always eat your vegetables. This will give you a bit of ability to see in the dark, mate.
So this is a...
You can see in the dark. You didn't see that coming. There's lots of them.
You're one up, right?
Yeah.
This is the last one.
Okay.
The film is Live and Let Die.
Never heard of it.
Yes, it is a Bond film.
Oh, sorry, yeah. I've heard of it.
You're James Bond.
Thank you.
And you managed to slip, in the middle of a battle, you managed to slip a pill inside your attacker's mouth. It makes his whole body start blowing up like a massive balloon. He shoots the top of the ceiling and explodes. You say...
Somebody give this guy a Finergan. Because he's just had a bad reaction to the other pill I've given him. Finergan is an antihistamine and it can reduce swelling. That's when Bond turns at the camera. Use only as directed. And if swelling persists, see Q or your healthcare professional.
Close. He went with, he always did have an inflated opinion of himself.
Not bad, but you did miss out a chance to do a good ad for Finergan.
Another prescription drug. Well done, Ham.
Yeah. Somebody call Twitter. This guy's blowing up. Give him a Finergan.
It's the happy hour. Hey, another email here if I can jump in.
Yeah.
From company man Angus. He said, I've noticed that you like to call people with the name Amy. Now, I haven't noticed that. He said, well, considering the sponsor is Amy, if you're sneaking in some more advertising, well done. Very clever.
Oh, mate, if we were, I'll take it.
Yeah, but we weren't. Maybe there's just been a flood of Amys on the show. I can't even remember. What I will remember, though, Ham, is the fact that Amy do have a one-day course available. People who have a license, but yeah, they want to be safer drivers. It's available if you've got a child or grandchild if you are a grandchild or a child of an Amy customer with comprehensive car insurance.
You get to do the course.
For free.
So it's sort of like mum or dad or grandma or grandpa. They're a lost cause to us now.
Yeah.
They're going to be dangerous forever, yeah, but I can be safe. Yeah, I get to do the course for free.
It might entitle you a 10% discount on your comprehensive car insurance until you turn 25 if you take the free course. Check it out, amy.com.au. The PDS is there.
Coming up next, we're talking to 25 people called Amy.
Pam, today the topic, of course, is action films. Tonight, we've got action TV.
Action-packed.
Slightly off-topic, but...
I wonder if it even is off-topic, Anna, because tonight's gap year, 8 o'clock, Channel 9.
you do feel obliged.
Channel 9!
To say it like that. I think because that guy's so boisterous. The guy that normally
I'd love to meet that guy. We've never... No idea who he is.
I hope he's very tiny. I hope he's very...
I hope it's a lady. 8 p.m. Channel 9 tonight. Gap year, Ando. Very exciting episode, because here we are at episode number 3 of the series.
Yeah.
And who should get to make a return but my old mate, the ultimate wingman.
It's very disappointing for me. I know some people have emailed in or been on Facebook and they've suggested that's very exciting, because we put up a little sneak peek of what the Ultimate Wingman got up to.
You might have seen it floating around on Facebook.
Yeah. Talk us through it, Ham. I mean,
well, we're in Japan.
If people don't know what the Ultimate Wingman is,
you don't know.
You're a self-appointed love coach.
You don't need to be appointed by anyone. The coach is there to do a job, and he does a great job. His job is to go out, make you look good in scenarios in front of girls. Did I or did I not achieve that?
I don't think you did.
I think I did. And I think I did a bloody good job. I think it was actually the most successful wingman we've ever done.
Well, you claim there's a kiss, and I don't think there is.
It's on tonight.
People can review the footage.
We were in Japan, though. One of my ideas, though, was to fake a CD launch for you when we were in Tokyo. Went to Tower Records. Mm. Not cheap, mate.
I know.
At no small cost.
When I get to come around the corner in Tokyo and I see on the side of a big building my face in big screens at Tower Records, and you've set up...
Mr. Cool Man.
Yeah. Well, not a great... Like, you say this...
It doesn't matter. It's written in English. Everyone's like, oh, that's cool. He's Western.
But you say this is to make me look good, and then you've chosen Mr. Cool Man as the idea.
Think of some of the great rap stars. Mr. Dobelina. He was a mister.
Maybe LL Cool J.
Yeah, cool. Cool is a cool word to have in your name.
Okay, so maybe if you got the name right.
Come around the corner.
I feel like...
Organised a guy to be the host, the MC. You know, guys, get ready, Mr. Cool Man's coming.
Yeah.
Crowd of people building up. Oh, who's small, this Mr. Cool Man?
Small crowd.
It was early in the morning. They wouldn't let me do it during the day.
My stomach bug with the whole thing was you... Obviously, you expected Mr. Cool Man to have a song.
You had to. It was his single launch.
Yeah.
It was meant to be a surprise for you. So I was left with the job of coming up with a great international hit.
Well, you recorded the song. Why didn't you get a better singer in to do it?
It was sort of a rush job, to be honest. And well, sometimes...
That makes sense, because if people have a listen, I've got a snippet for everyone
actually,
here.
Actually, sometimes when you're doing a rush job, that's when your best work can happen.
Okay, well, people can be the judge. Have a listen.
This is an international hit called Heartbeat Ringtone.
When I'm at home, and the phone's antenna is your collarbone. Your heartbeat is my ringtone.
What does that even mean?
So your heartbeat's my ringtone. Yeah. So it's sort of like...
What? I like your heartbeat being around all the day? Or I like hearing your heartbeat when someone's calling me?
All of that. Whatever it makes you think of.
Okay.
What was the next bit? Bosoms of my telephone. Yeah. So then I'm sort of just thinking, all right, if your heart's the ringtone, what else is sort of around that area on a girl? Bosoms. So that would be fun to talk to.
So that's
bosoms.
Not a metaphor. That's not a metaphor. That is
what it is. It's more just like you know, if we get alone, I might have a chat with your bosoms. And then once I was really thinking about that sort of pure girl as a telephone image, that's where the great line about the collarbone being the antenna to the telephone is. So sort of it all checks out. You got a great. It's sort of a physical description of a girl going. You got a great body. It all works. Yeah. It's all as good, you know, for me, it's as perfect as a smartphone.
And fun tonight, Channel 9.
And whether or not that came across, because I assume a lot of people listen. You don't really get to hear enough of the song, to be honest, tonight. That's a shame.
Well, we cut a lot of it out. So
well, the crowd was listening to it. The crowd was loving it. And I think they got the gist of it. There's a lot of moshy moshy and stuff as the backing track that's for the Japanese
What's
crowd.
What's moshy moshy mean?
I think that's what you say on the telephone. It's where you say hello in Japan. Moshy moshy?
Really?
Yeah. I mean, listen, how's all these questions? I put a lot of work into that song.
What's kawaii mean?
Kawaii means cute. So I'm in the background basically saying, hello, cute, hello, cute. And
thumbprint.
This is from Happy Chappy, David. He wrote and he said, look, guys, old film, nothing to do with action, old news, nothing to do with action films. Yeah. Took a picture of a sign you might be interested in, and it's just a sign that says miniature horses for sale. And he writes in under action films, but he does look, you know, apologies, obviously nothing to do with an action film.
Well, that probably sort of a follow-up from Tiny Versions of Things.
True.
We were talking about that as a topic for the day, and that girl we found out was the winner.
Yeah, she had the championship miniature horse.
Of Australia, well done.
Now, Dave, you write in and you say nothing to do with action films, but yet you underestimate the... research department of this show.
Yeah, that's right.
Is miniature horses nothing to do with action films? If it is, then how come we just found a trailer for a brand new film, which is an action film about miniature horses?
Touché.
Just when you thought it was safe.
No, of course you can walk in this paddock.
What about much smaller than usual horses?
No, not around here, mate.
Just when you thought horses couldn't get any smaller.
Like, I mean, we have horses on the small side of the size spectrum for their age.
What about foals, which are the babies of regular horses?
We have foals from regular horses, sure, but no smaller than that, I can assure you.
Along come...
What the heck is that?
Miniature horses.
Run! Get the kids in the house! How are they still chasing us?
They're getting through the cat flap!
This horseplay is one action-packed game you do not want to lose.
It's got a gun!
That's okay, it can't fire it because they haven't got index fingers, only hoofs. Impossible!
Miniature horses. With index fingers, enabling firearm use. In cinemas now.
Very long title.
I know.
This is Hamish and Andy's Happy Hour.
Today it's action films, but tomorrow it might be Roses.
It's not.
Or Oprah. No, it's not. Neither of those things. I'm just saying.
That's what it could be.
You know, it just happened to be sort of a boy-friendly topic.
Yeah.
But we've had a lot of, we've explored a lot of different facets.
Hey, great correspondence here from Happy Chappy Johnny Dougalbath.
Yeah.
Writes in saying, in action films, why are the police are so bad at shooting the bad guys?
Yeah, that includes stormtroopers in that.
Too. Yeah. If I was a balaclava wearing loot stealing bandit, so he's gone for balaclava rather than a mask of some description, I would feel rather confident that I had a pretty good chance that most bullets would miss me, only break my rear windscreen, at worst case, hit my shoulder, but I'd definitely be okay.
There are an amazing amount of shots fired through windows that don't land inside a person by police in action films.
Johnny Dougalbath joins us now. How are you, Johnny?
Hey, boys. How are you?
Yeah, very good, Johnny.
You say here in your correspondence, if I was a balaclava wearing loot-stealing bandit, you'd feel pretty safe. Well, we thought we'd give you the opportunity to be that virtually through the radio today, if you're happy to play along. Just to let us know what kind of car that you might be driving if you're trying to get away from, say, a bank robber. Robbery?
Let's just say it's a light truck of some sort.
Okay. A light truck. Interesting you've chosen an Isuzu 1-ton truck over anything faster. But that's fine because you don't need speed. Mm. You just need to be lucky. I will be the policeman, Johnny. Now, bearing in mind, I'm trailing you. Yeah. And are you going to narrate here?
I'll narrate. So, obviously, we don't have the benefit of moving pictures at the moment. We've only got sound. So, I'll narrate for everyone in their cars. Hopefully, anyone that's currently in a robbery or some kind of getaway doesn't think that these gunshots are for them.
No, although that would be an amazing coincidence. And we must tell you to hand yourself in immediately. Here's the thing, though, Johnny. Listen to what happens. You've got to listen to the action that takes place. Then we'll stop and you tell us how you think you're going in the scene, all right?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. All right, you're taking off, Johnny, in your small light van. Hamish, you've just jumped in your car, you've ripped around the corner in the cop car and you're firing off a few shots.
Freeze! Halt!
Now you're gone.
That's fine, I can do this in public because I'm an American cop.
Okay, so he's still going and at the moment, Ham, you haven't even shot any of his car.
Well, then I'll... Keep squeezing off a few.
Anything happened there, Johnny? Have we got you at all?
Look, despite what I wrote on you, you did. Yes, you got me.
I got you! Yes! Score one for the cops!
That's incredible!
Credits roll. It's a 9-minute film. Audiences boo, but on the way out of the film, some can be heard saying, well, it's nice to see that for a change.
Johnny, thank you very much for playing along, mate.
Thanks a lot. Cheers.
Good one.
Incredible turn of events.
Amazing.
And the most realistic film we've
seen. If that happened, would you feel ripped off in a film? If that was the opening scene of Heat and most of the guys got done and like then the cops are just standing there going, well, you know, it's never a good news when there's a loss of life, but that's it. There's absolutely no one left in this bank robbing gang and the credits roll and the lights come up in the cinema.
Yeah, I'd be disappointed. Exactly the same as if Harrison Ford turned around and said, I didn't kill my wife, and they went, oh, our mistake.
You're off.
And you're off the
letting you off, and we're compensating you for trauma.
So we've got time for this happy hour. Keep your correspondence coming in. The emails at hamishnanny.com/topics. Really nicely done.
Thanks,
from Johnny.
Thanks, Johnny. Well, you could have said you were fine. I mean, that's kind of where we thought that was going to go, but I do like that you shut it down.
Also, the podcast always available without songs or ads. You can listen to it at hamishnanny.com. We'll catch you tomorrow.
See you later.
That was the Hamish and Andy Show podcast, powered by Amy. Lucky you're with Amy.